I'll give you the quick introduction. There's some slides in here that we'll talk to in a second, but my name is James Fratsky. I am a proud graduate of Cal State Fullerton, and specifically Mihailo College, business major, marketing. But one of the most informative classes that Ryan and I took at Mihailo was JJ's entrepreneurial marketing class. And it really forced us to step outside of the classroom and work on a project and not only like learn from a business perspective how to interact with the client, but also from an interpersonal communication perspective, learn how to work with fellow students who, you know, one day could be your coworkers or your bosses or your employees. So it was a very neat experience. And we're going to share a lot of great things that we started to kind of learn about, and that spark was ignited for us in JJ's class. And so this is kind of a cool full circle experience for us.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Ryan, twin brother to James Fratsky. I am 45 minutes older. I don't know if anyone could tell.
I was going to point that out, by the way.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Very good.
I am taller, though.
Which I'm not sure how that happened or what the deal is there. But yeah, I think that what I love about the entrepreneurial department at the school is that it really does force you to be in a high-impact learning situation and actually step out of your comfort zone. I think when we took JJ's class, it was like, wait a second, classes like this actually exist here? We're going to go out there and work.
You were a little threatened at the beginning. I recall. There was some tension.
Yeah, I think so. And we worked through it. But I think that class has pushed us to really think about digital marketing in a slightly different way. We do work for an agency, Brandify. It's a national agency. We work with enterprise-level brands, and we'll talk about that here. But a lot of the concepts that we're looking at are the same strategies that we advise our national brands on, but we've broken them down in a way where entrepreneurs or small business owners, which sometimes are the same thing, can actually take these tactics and run with them. So if there's anyone in the room tonight that wants to start a business, this is some good stuff. This is some bootstrap stuff that you can actually start implementing tomorrow. Or maybe you want to go work for an agency. There's stuff in here today that will make you dangerous in an interview and make you a valued member of the team. So that's what we'd like to cover. You know, normally we talk to different size groups. Groups like this, I think sitting might actually be more comfortable. But as we go through, we normally work in like a Q&A at the end. But I think we have an intimate enough group that if you have questions while we're going, just feel free to jump in and we'll make it more of a dialogue.
With that, welcome. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking time out of your day. You can't save time. You can't give time to other people. All you can do is spend it. And so it means a lot to us that you're spending time with us here today. Appreciate that. When we kick off some of these workshops with students, we share a story about how one of our professors challenged us to always reach one inch higher. And typically what I do is ask the students to lift their hands up into the air. So could you guys lift your hands up into the air real quick for me? All right. And now give me one more inch. And then the point is you can put your hands down now. The point there is that, you know, we always are leaving a little bit in the reserve, right? I asked you to put your hands up and there was still an extra inch you could go, right? And so when you're going through the course today, take some of these items. We're gonna touch them at a high level. Some we might go a little deeper into, but the ones that really stand out to you, my challenge to you is to take them back home with you and go just that one inch higher, that one inch further, and start looking at some blogs and start digging into some pieces and start to figure out how it can apply to your business or your profession or your passion project or whatever that may be. So the agenda is we've done introductions, which is good. We won't go over too much of that anymore, but there's one other question I want to ask everybody in the room just to get a sense of your skill level for digital marketing. Then we'll jump right into our seven principles for digital marketing. So through our time at Brandify and even starting some of our own businesses, Ryan and I have really dialed digital marketing into seven key areas. And we're going to cover all seven of those today. Some, again, we'll drill in a little deeper than others. And then we'll do a Q&A. So if there's any questions you have, feel free to ask them, and we'll try to reserve some time at the end to answer more questions as well. Part of the marketing for tonight was this is an opportunity to ask smart questions and get smart answers. So that doesn't mean that there's a such thing as a stupid question or answer, but I just want to let you know that we're here as long as we need to be in order to make sure that you guys feel like you got some solid intel leaving this room with. And so the purpose is to introduce the 7 principles of digital marketing and start to develop a basic understanding of the best practices and techniques to grow your business online and in person. So for a lot of the folks here, I've heard, you know, app ideas or online ideas, great. A lot of these techniques will help to increase traffic online, but 93% of commerce is still happening at brick and mortar stores, right? So this is, how do we get people from that online experience to potentially an in-person purchase as well? So you shared your names, we appreciate that. Shared your businesses, roles, goals, graduation dates, appreciate that as well. Let's go around the room one more time and let's give ourselves a score, 1 to 10. And you don't know what the 7 principles are yet, but just give us a general idea for where you feel your comfort level lies with digital marketing. Are you 1, you don't know anything about it, or are you a 10, you're an expert, and you're just here to tell us we're wrong the whole night?
Which is fine, we'll take it.
Yeah. So we'll start right here. What is your skill level, digital marketing?
What's a 5?
I guess a 5 would probably be you've built your own website, and you dabble around on social media, but you're not ranking as high as you'd like to in search, and nobody's liking your stuff.
7.
Okay, great.
Yeah, I agree with your 7, yeah. Say 5 or 6.
Okay.
Mine's probably like 2 or something. Like, I don't do digital stuff. I actually, my partner did the website. I have no idea how to do it, how he did it. I'm like amazed. I'm like, oh, this is...
Can we get your partner on the line? No, I'm just kidding. Call him up.
He would probably be like a 9 or something.
Cool.
-4.
Wow. Okay. Thank you for being so...
Probably fall 5.
Okay.
Okay. Great.
Great. Wendy?
Between a 1 and a 2, I've taken some classes that went over like web page design and a little bit of, you know, marketing, but I haven't done anything in social media marketing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
6 or 7.
Great. Thanks, Travis.
So about 7.
7?
12 team.
That's what I'm saying. JJ, you got to be at least a 10.
I wouldn't let you go for anything less than that. Okay, great. I would say that, you know, I always like to leave a little bit more room for learning. I think every day is a learning opportunity. So I'll say a 9 just to try and be humble and give myself a point to work towards.
I'm definitely like a 9.5. No, I'm just kidding. I mean,
so competitive.
So 45, competitive. I have 45 extra minutes of experience, right? So, no, I'm just kidding. Okay. That's how much older I am.
So I'll take that then. So here's a little bit more about us. Ryan and I work at Brandify. It's a digital marketing agency here in Orange County. Fun story was how we started there. The CEO was actually a guest speaker in one of JJ's classes, and we got introduced, and the rest was history. So we've been there for almost 3 years now. The yellow picture there is a animation of Ryan and I. We're serial entrepreneurs. We started our first landscaping business when we were 12. We started a graphic design business when we were 17. We had our own booth in the mall for starting on Black Friday, and we worked 12-hour days all the way through the holidays. That was kind of cool. We worked at Disney for 4 years. We started off in attractions there, but very quickly found some managers that took a liking to us and started working in special events marketing. So anytime Disney's on TV or they're on the radio and there's, hey, we're live from the Disneyland Resort and we're giving away tickets today. That was the team that Ryan and I were on. We helped facilitate those events. We started a YouTube channel based off of some of the things we were learning in JJ's class and starting to say, hey, we don't have all the digital things down like we'd like to, so let's start a passion project. So we started the YouTube channel, we started a blog, and that actually gave us a cool opportunity to start talking to really cool bands that were on the radio, and that grew. And that was something we were able to put on our resume and say, hey, we've grown our likes by this much, or we have this much traffic. So that was kind of a cool thing we did. And we were the commencement speakers at our graduation back in 2014. So that was a really cool opportunity for us as well. So it's been kind of a neat experience. Here's some of the clients that we work with at Brandify. So Dollar Tree, In-N-Out, Advance Auto Parts, Walmart, Disney Stores, Jelly Belly, Chick-fil-A, The North Face, Dick's Sporting Goods. And really what we're tasked with as strategic account managers is making sure that we understand who the client is, and what their needs are, specifically online, and then what are our product solutions that might be able to give them results that they're looking for. And so when we start to identify those things, Ryan and I work on strategic plans to present to the client. Sometimes we go and meet them at their headquarters and walk them through, hey, if you spend this amount of money with us, this is your return on investment. This is the amount of traffic that you can expect to see coming to your stores or participating in this event or whatever it may be.
I think one thing that's interesting to note is that a majority, our firm is very different than other marketing agencies or digital marketing agencies, because a lot of times they'll lean towards advertising efforts, and we do a lot of digital advertising, and we'll talk about it today. But a majority of the solutions that we propose are based around organic traffic, right? And that's actually pretty interesting because it's a little bit harder to track those metrics. It's becoming easier now as we build out beacons and things like that where we can actually track when did someone step into the store versus when they actually interacted with the brand online. But what's fascinating about organic traffic is that you are employing strategies to really capture that long tail of people that may be searching for unbranded keywords, things like, you know, how do I get someone who's searching for sneakers to go to a Walmart to purchase their stuff rather than like a Payless, right? So those are the things that we're competing with, which is pretty fascinating.
Mm-hmm. And then we're gonna jump into these are our seven principles. So the first is website and SEO. When we think digital, it's kind of a hub and spoke model, and the center of that hub is definitely your website. That's where you're gonna be directing a lot of traffic to in order to give your customers the information they need to either visit you in a store, RSVP online, or make a purchase online. Then we wanna talk about content. After that, we'll go into social media, so we'll definitely cover some social media tips and best practices. We'll talk about email marketing, digital advertising, and then we'll get into kind of how your customer interacts with your brand online and what they're saying about you. So we'll talk about online reviews, and then we'll finish with listings management, and we'll kind of explain what that is. Now, these seven principles and this entire kind of abbreviated hour and a half presentation that we're giving tonight is actually part of our 6-hour boot camp that we're doing at Mihaela College next Saturday. So on November 5th, we're doing a 6-hour boot camp. You can see some of the stuff here. We'll get into it a little bit more. So let's jump right into the first pillar or the first principle, websites and SEO. I want to talk specifically about SEO, which is search engine optimization. So let me read you the definition real quick, and then we can start to have a conversation. Search engine optimization, SEO, is the process of affecting the visibility of a brand's website or web page in search engines' natural or unpaid organic search results. What does this mean? A lot of folks, when they're looking for a product or a company or a service, what's the first thing they'll do?
Google.
They'll Google it, right? It could be Bing, it could be Yahoo, but 70% of searches that happen online are on Google. So throughout this presentation, oftentimes we'll refer to that platform specifically, but they'll Google it, right? So they might go and say, okay, I'm looking for a sporting goods store near me, or I'm looking for pizza near me. And the goal of any company is to show up as high up on the first page result as you can, right? So ideally, you want to be that number one ranked position that shows up, hey, James's Pizza. So what you need to do is try to optimize your website to make sure that you're telling Google, that you're sending the right signals to Google to say, hey, I'm the best pizza place, or I'm the closest pizza place to this particular person, or I have this specific, very special pizza that they're looking for. And you do that through some key techniques. So what I'm gonna do is share my top five SEO techniques. This is where I would start to take notes, yeah.
So as James jumps into this, it's important to have some perspective. A lot of people, there was a study that came out recently, and it was a group that was surveyed, and I'll tell you more about the group in a second, but 43% of the folks that were surveyed in this group did not know what the acronym SEO meant, right? So what group was surveyed? It was a group of folks who had admitted to either have started a website or ran an online business. So 43% of the people that were surveyed in this group didn't realize what SEO meant, and the folks that did sort of went, well, isn't that something I've got to pay some agency thousands of dollars for so that I can show up on page one, right? And I have to keep paying them. That's sort of what the world of SEO has become. But generally speaking, it's pretty simple. It's search engine optimization. So how do you optimize your web page so that the algorithm that Google has likes it, right? So how do you optimize it in such a way that it fits in or that it's sending the right signals? And so the things that we want to show you today, when done right, will actually help your page get that, you know, that first position without having to have someone building a link farm on the back end or some black hat technique where someone is, you know, doing a lot of, well, basically linking, false linking and things like that. So this is basic stuff, but a lot of folks don't realize how easy it is to go in there and edit it or what it really means to Google. And so this is, if you're starting a website, this is like first thing you want to do, or if you're consulting with someone who has a website, these easy tactics are going to allow you to actually start ranking really quickly.
Yeah, and so if you already have a website, to Ryan's point, you know, go back and revisit these 5 points and see if you're doing everything that you could be in order to properly optimize. So I call these the low effort, high impact actions. So the first is starting with your title tag. Every website has a title tag. What that's doing is it's kind of the first place that Google sends its spider, right? There's this robot that crawls every website on the internet, and the first place it looks is the title tag. And this is done on the back end. So if you're on like a Weebly or Squarespace, usually there's an SEO section and you can type in your title. If you have a WordPress or your website is kind of built from scratch, it's a little bit more difficult to actually do the coding. But if you have a webmaster or somebody that you work with to help build the website, then they'll know how to help you edit the title tag. But a lot of times web developers are really good at building websites, but they're not as good on the SEO side, right? Or being creative. So that's where you as a business owner have to kind of take charge and think about, okay, how do I put my best foot forward? So I'll go into a demo, but I also want to go down this list real quick. So the next part is keywords and content. So the first thing they look at is the title tag.
Can I hit pause really quick?
Yep.
I know you're all thinking it. I'm going to be the guy who says it. Your arm keeps blocking that stuff. No. So stop reaching in front of
that. I don't do that.
I wanted to be in front of the camera.
Thank you, Ryan.
You're welcome.
So, moral of the story is, first thing they look at is the title tag. The next thing they're going to do is look at the content on the page. So what does your actual landing page say about your website? And what Google wants to do is, you know, with a high percentage of certainty, make sure that when somebody searches for a given item or product, that they're serving the best possible pages to the customer. Because that's going to get the customer to keep coming back to Google, and the more they come back to Google, the higher the likelihood is that they'll click on an ad and Google will make money, right? That's how Google makes money, is through the ads. So they want to keep people happy and keep coming back to Google. So they'll look at the title tag, then they'll look at the content on the actual page. So you want to make sure that those two things are consistent. What you say the site is about should actually be what that landing page is about. The next part is the meta description. So again, this is a back-end piece that you can code on platforms like Squarespace and Weebly and Wix. There'll be a section for you to put in the meta description. The next part you want to look at is image titles and alt tags. So we have images on our website, but I don't know if you know this, Google can't read images, right? Can't interpret images. But what it can do is say, oh, there's a tag on the back end that's coded, that's attached to that image that says what it is. So if it's a picture of puppies, then you want to make sure that you go on the back end and say puppies, golden retriever, cute, whatever it is, right? And that's how Google will know to display it in its image searches, and it will continue to give you more bonus points to your page and say, okay, the title tag, the content, the pictures are consistent, the meta description is consistent. And then you want to think about how you set up your URLs. And that's obviously what pops up when you type in a website. www.fratskybrothers.com is a URL. And so you want to make sure whatever comes after the .com is consistent with what your page is about as well, because Google is cross-checking all 5 of those things to say, okay, is this page actually relevant to show to my consumer? We'll dive in more in our boot camp, but I want to give you a closer look at title tags specifically. So here's a client of ours, Dick's Sporting Goods. Now you're looking at the page and you're thinking, okay, how do I know what the title tag is here? You'll right click with your mouse and that will bring up this little dialog box that you see here. And then you want to click on View Page Source. Once you've done that, you will see this very confusing, it's HTML. A lot of code, yeah, HTML, right? But you'll be able to kind of quickly determine, based off of this thing that says title right here, that this is the title tag, right? So it says Dick's Sporting Goods official site. Every season starts at Dick's. Now, I've also outlined here the result that's being displayed in Google. You notice how the title tag and the result is the exact same. So, spoiler alert, you can tell Google what you want your site to be listed as to the consumer. But what if you don't put in a title tag? Then Google reserves the right to make up their own. So they crawl the page and they try to put together the smorgasbord of, okay, I think this is what this website is about, right? But if you go in and you put in a title tag, you're waving this big red flag saying, hey, Google, I've done the work for you. This is what my site is about. Now, you'll also notice that there's some dots here at the end. This is called truncation, or it's being truncated, right? It's being shortened. So what's the best practice here? Your title tag should be about 55 characters, right? So no more, no less. If you have any less, you're losing an opportunity to communicate your value to the customer. If you have more, it's gonna get cut off anyways. And then you wanna start with, in your title tag, usually whatever the key word is that is related to your product. So to Ryan's point earlier, if it's shoes, you want that key word to be at the beginning of your title tag. Now, Dick's Sporting Goods has some brand power. And because they have brand power, if you have strong brand power, it's usually recommended that you start with your brand in your title tag, and then you work your way to the keywords. But for startups, you probably want to work the opposite direction. So what is it you're selling? If it's shoes, start with shoes. If it's athletic shoes, then go athletic shoes. I mean, the more specific you can get, the better. Again, if you're trying to sell in a local market, like Fullerton, then the next thing I would do is like keyword and then my market, Fullerton, right? That way, when somebody's searching, they're not gonna, if they're searching for Fullerton, they're gonna know, hey, this guy's in Fullerton. Google's more likely to serve up a local result for somebody that's searching locally than they are to serve up a national result, right? And then you wanna kind of finish it off with your brand name if you have of the space. So I would start with your keyword that you're trying to target, location specific information, and then the brand, whatever you are, James Shoe Shop, whatever it is. Any questions about title tags? How many people knew that you could edit this and tell Google what you wanted the customer to see? Okay, well, that makes sense. We got a 7. Oh, you were the 9.
No,
were you 7?
7.
Okay, good. This is huge. If you're making a website or you already have one, I would start here. Spend some time. You know, we learn about mission statements and vision statements and mantras and all. It's kind of like your website's mantra. Short, to the point, 55 characters. What are you telling your customer? What are you telling the search engines? And then you want to make sure that that's consistent with the content that's on your page. So if we're talking about shoes, that's our key word, then you want to make sure that we mention that you sell shoes, that you carry different types of shoes, what type of shoes do you carry on that landing page, so Google can cross-reference and say, okay, I'm pretty certain this website is going to make somebody happy if they click on it, if they searched for shoes in Fullerton.
And this is where the inexperienced web designer falls down on the job,
right,
or someone who's cutting corners. And
yeah,
that's why you have to challenge your designer to make sure that they're taking advantage of the different tag options.
Absolutely.
Yeah, great point.
And I think that that's the challenge sometimes. When you hire somebody to build a website, it's because that's not your strength, it's their strength. But again, we're hopefully arming you with some things that can make you a little bit more dangerous when you're having those conversations. Hey, did we do the title tag yet? No? Okay, well, let's spend some time on the phone talking about what we think the best tag is, and can you make sure that you implement that tonight? I was consulting with a karate dojo. Interesting website, it was a little bit older, but they didn't have a title tag. And he was saying, James, how do I get on the first page? As a consultant, you're almost like, well, how much do I want to draw this out? And then that's not who I am. So I'm like, yeah, if you just change the title tag real quick, you're going to show up in no time, because there's a lot of great content, but Google doesn't know who you are or what you do. He did that. He went from not being on the page at all to being on the first page, sixth position. Now we're trying to work him up to that first position. Then the next thing I want to show you, I talked about meta description in my top five, right? So you'll see below title, it says meta, name equals description. And you'll notice it says visit Dick's, and there's some coding there. Then it says sporting goods and shop. You'll notice that that's exactly what it says in the Google listing as well. So you can actually write that for Google as well. And what you'll do, or what you'll want to do, is when you edit this on your website, it might take several days for it to actually go live on Google. But give it about a week and then do some Google searches and see, is my title tag consistent with what Google's saying about my site? If it's not, after about a week, then you might want to go back and revisit your title tag, because Google crawled your page and said, okay, they told me what they wanted to say, but I still don't think that's the best option. So that's kind of a nice way to check whether you wrote the title tag the best way you possibly could. All right, so there's a lot more that we would talk about website and SEO in the bootcamp, but we're gonna kind of pause there. Here's some helpful tools. We work at Brandify, so I would be remiss if I didn't say Brandify. But also Google Analytics. If your website's not hooked up to Google Analytics, I strongly encourage you to do that. It's gonna allow you to track sessions and page views. It's also gonna allow you to see bounce rates and session times. So for instance, we have a blog. And if I go into Google Analytics and one of my very lengthy blog posts, the average session view time is 30 seconds, then I can assume that people aren't reading that blog post, right? But on average, we see that it's about 4 to 5 minutes. And I say, okay, people are taking the time to actually write that post. That was a successful post. On average, people are spending about 3 to 4 minutes on our bootcamp landing page. I can say, okay, we must have done a decent job there, because there's a lot of content and people seem to be reading it. But if it's 20 seconds, then it's time to revisit. Go ahead.
Google Analytics, also for anyone who's trying to make a purchase, not a purchase, but is trying to sell online, so e-commerce, you can start getting really sophisticated with it. We'll talk a little bit about advertising towards the end here, but what's interesting is that you can actually start tracking what did the person search for to get to the page, how long were they on the page, and then did they eventually make a purchase, right? So did they buy the thing that you were intending for them to buy? And what gets really fun is if you've got the time to start doing some A/B testing. So for the same product, can you set up two separate landing pages and see which one gets more traffic? If you see, okay, A is getting more traffic and you used a different set of keywords, then you can, you know, actually delete the second one and then use page A for your advertising. So there's things that you can do to start optimizing these pages and test things out. And Google Analytics is a primarily free tool that you can leverage to start learning more about how people are actually interacting. And what's fun is Google's going through the process of monetizing analytics. So they've sort of launched this platinum suite now that has enhanced tools, but for the most part, you can get everything that you need out of this free tool.
It's really easy to set up as well. You just need to drop some code onto your website. Webmaster should be able to help. If you have a platform like Weebly or Wix, there's a little footer section. It says, put your Google Analytics code here. So relatively simple. Search Console is definitely something that a lot of people don't spend time on, but this will show you the kind of keywords that people are searching to get to your site. So for our music blog, we found out that a lot of people landed on our blog post about cool indie rock songs for your birthday. They were looking for playlists. And that was a little piece of our site, very little. But we found that there was so much traffic coming to it that we built that out to its own little page, its own little section. And so it's a good way to kind of understand why people are coming to your site. And then Moz is a great blog to check out. When I talk about going that one inch further, Moz is a great place to learn the newest SEO trends and different things to stay up on. All right.
Cool. All right, so now we go into the content section of this. James talked about the website being one of those main spots that you're going to capture people coming in, and that's true. But content is probably going to be one of the most important things, right? So it's not about just having the page, but what does the content on the page say? And then let's take it a step further. Do you have a blog where you're posting additional content? And not only that, but can you start thinking of creative ways to take one big idea and chop it up to 10 different little ideas, right? So one of the things that James and I try to do when we're thinking of crafting a cool blog post is, can we do a blog post? Can we make a video about that blog post on YouTube? Can we chop that blog post into, you know, 10 separate Facebook posts? Can we take that and make it 3 different Instagram things, right? And all those different pieces of content that we're chopping up are pointing back to your website, right? So this is all about driving traffic to the website, because the website's where you can get the most information about the user. And then ultimately, if you're trying to sell things online, that's where the purchase is going to happen. But for many years, and even today, a lot of folks say that content is king. But we feel, and especially at Brandify, this is so important, that content is very important, but it's the context that's king, right? So who are you talking to? What is the message you're trying to convey? And what's sort of your end result that you're trying to get from it? So this is a really simplified equation that we like to think about whenever we're thinking, hey, we want to promote something or we want to sort of drive a very specific action. We try to take a step back and think about the context around the current environment out there. So a good piece of content starts with thinking about, where do you want to release it? So is it going to be on your blog? Is it going to be a video on YouTube? Is it going to be Facebook? Typically, James and I like to say, let's start with the blog and then how can we chop it up? But some people's digital strategy might be, hey, we're really into Instagram, right? The kind of content that you post on Instagram is going to be very different from what you post on Twitter or what you post on Facebook. So when I say content, I'm basically saying think about where you're going to post it and what parameters that you need to fit within. And then people. So this really is a simple way of saying, who is your audience? Who am I trying to speak to? So for a couple of years, I was the digital marketing manager for Royal Hawaiian Orchards, which is the biggest, they own like 90% of the macadamia nut farms in the US. So if you've ever eaten a macadamia nut, it probably came from them. And we had an interesting challenge. When I came on board, the company had just switched from pretty much exclusively selling private label, just basically shipping the nuts out to whoever needed them, to saying, you know what, we're actually going to start, you know, ending our contracts with these private label folks so that we can actually get more of the macadamia nuts, and they launched their own brand. So now we want to sell these nuts branded at a premium price. So we started thinking about, who do we want to sell this to? And our core market was educated women who are looking to snack healthy and are looking for additional health benefits from the foods that they're snacking on. And we had a lot of science around that there's good fats in macadamia nuts, and so we were trying to push that. So when I stepped in, I took over from an agency that was just sort of trying to push the products to whoever. You know, it didn't matter, let's get it out there. But we had to take a step back and say, well, who are the people we're trying to talk to? And what are the sort of things that appeal to them? And so what we did was we created these individual, first we started with sort of this customer avatar. So we created an image of what does the ideal customer look like, but not only look like, what do they do? Where do they work? Where do they live? How much do they actually spend on snacking? What are the moments that they snack? When they snack the most? And so we developed a strategy around 4 buckets. And those buckets were, okay, work snacking, you know, adding to your meals, workout, and then like travel and vacation. Like how do you relax? Because we had the whole benefit of being Hawaiian. So we could go off this idea of aloha. Where's your aloha? And so when we stopped and broke it down into those buckets, we made sure we were focusing our efforts on those 4 buckets. And if an idea came up that didn't appeal to one of those 4 buckets, we didn't do it, right? We made sure that we focused on, who are we trying to sell to? Let's create content for them. And then you want to think about the time. And when I say time, I really mean It's the environment around your ideal customer. So what are the sort of things that are going on in their world? And what's going to be important to them? Are there events that are going on that you need to make sure you create content around? Or are there events going on that you're not gonna bother, right? So for Royal Hawaiian Orchards, when National Donut Day came along, we didn't create a piece of content around that that was donut related. But when National Nut Day came along, we of course jumped on that. Or when National Yoga Day came along, because we were focusing on fitness, we jumped on that, right? One good example is Oreo. I don't know if anyone remembers the game. It was San Francisco versus
the Ravens.
The Ravens won that, right?
They did.
That's a bummer. Yeah. We're big Steeler fans. But during that Super Bowl,
Take care.
Yeah, enjoy. Thanks for being here. I don't know if you guys remember that Super Bowl, but the lights went out halfway through. Mm-hmm. And the most successful campaign came from Oreo. They won awards on this, and it wasn't a commercial that they paid millions of dollars for that 30-second spot. It was literally a black picture posted on Facebook, and it had words, "You can still dunk in the dark," right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, the lights are out, but you can still dunk. Why did they do that? Because they understood, one, where did they want to post their content? They thought, we're not going to get any bang for our buck doing a commercial. Let's do social, but let's do social in real time. So they had a room similar to this. They had their graphic designer, they had their lawyer, and they had their content people sitting in a room watching the Super Bowl, waiting for the right moment to do something contextual, right, around the people that they wanted to appeal to, which were the folks that were watching the game. You know, these are younger, mostly males who are into snacking on things that aren't necessarily healthy because they're going to make it up the next day in the gym, right? So they're eating Oreos, they're eating, you know, the different things during the game. And so they posted that, they spent the least, they got a huge sort of engagement, people going to their website, and they won awards based off of it because they kept in mind, what's the kind of content we want to go after? Let's not do things that we don't think are going to work. Who are the people, and what are they participating in? Yeah.
They did that during the game?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was quick.
It was quick. It was real time. Right, because as you look at studies that are out there, people are creating sort of these two-screen experiences when they're watching TV now. And that's even if they're watching it on a TV, right? So I don't know how many of you have your laptop or your phone out when you're watching TV, but I definitely do. And sometimes when commercials come up, I'll jump on my phone or, you know, whatever the situation is. Some folks, even at the NFL, provides a second screen experience. So hey, when the commercials are on, come over to NFL.com and you can see things from different angles, right? So Oreo understood this trend and knew that their core audience was going to be highly tuned into social media. That's why they wanted to post content there. And then obviously the lights went out. So what's everyone going to do? Jump to Facebook and talk about it. So it was highly shared and really, really engaging. So that's sort of our main role. Other things that I want you to think about when you're thinking social, and we talk about this a lot in the boot camp, but too often, when I was brought into Royal Hawaiian Orchards, the CEO basically said, like, let's get on everything. Let's do Pinterest, let's do Twitter, let's do Instagram, can we do YouTube? And you have to take a step back as someone who's trying to get the most bang for their buck. You only have so much time in a day, only so much bandwidth. You have to look at each platform and think about, is my customer there? Are they looking? So when I did that analysis, I said, okay, our customer is on Facebook. They're on Pinterest, because Pinterest is primarily, the population there is primarily women. And they're on Instagram. And so that's what we went after, rather than going everywhere. James has an interesting example, which I'll share quickly, which is he started working for basically a company that provided loans for small businesses. And he was brought in to consult as sort of a social media expert. Again, the CEO of this company says, let's get on everything. James does an analysis, steps back and says, your core customer are the loan officers at banks. They're probably not jumping on Facebook to figure out the best spot to work with. What are the
CDC
loans?
So, which is a very interesting topic, and I highly encourage you guys to look into it. There's this whole SBA loan process where you can basically, if you don't have the full funds, you go to your bank and say, I'm looking for a loan. They say, well, we can only support 50% of the loan. And then the SBA CDC loan agencies will cover the remaining 40%, and then you as a business owner is responsible for the last 10%. It's interesting stuff. To Ryan's point, we use LinkedIn to communicate with loan officers because they were the ones that kind of shelled out the CDC business. So it was more important to start making connections and relationships with them on LinkedIn so that when that next loan came in, they go, oh yeah, Landmark is pretty good. You should work with them. And so we closed some deals. And Ryan, you're actually transitioning now into our social media piece, which is good. So a lot more at the boot camp for content, but we wanted to start, we think that context piece is so important when you're looking at content. Okay, so let's go into social media real quick. Here's the definition. Social media platforms are computer-mediated tools that allow people, companies, and other organizations to create, share, or exchange information, career interests, ideas, pictures, and videos in virtual communities and networks. Thank you, Wikipedia. So let's look at some social networks. To Ryan's point, there's lots of options out there. Facebook, MySpace. Who's still on MySpace? No one? Okay. In a larger room, people laugh when I say that. But, you know, it's a smaller room. Okay, Snapchat, Instagram, LinkedIn, Pinterest, Google+, Twitter, Pokemon Go, maybe. I mean, that was pretty cool for a little while. Foursquare. So kind of the experiment here is think about your business, think about these platforms, and start to unpack, okay, like where do I want to spend most of my time? You have limited resources, you have limited time, you have limited money. Don't fall into the trap of thinking, okay, I need to be on all of these things. We'll get into an exercise in a second where we will kind of try to figure out, okay, what's best for your business. But I want to share some interesting facts with you. So of the 7.2 billion people on Earth, 3 billion have internet access, and 2.1 billion are active on social media every day. 1.7 billion use social networks from their mobile device. So that's, say I'm in line, or I'm at a red light, or another joke, okay. Yeah, they're using it on their mobile device, which is important because we have to think, okay, it's not just I'm, you know, sitting at work on social media. It's another joke. No? Okay. You know, it's with you all the time, every day, right here in your hand. The number of worldwide social media users is expected to reach 2.5 billion by 2018. So it continues to increase. 70% of the U.S. population has at least one social networking profile. So of the ones that we just went over, they have at least one of those, right? They might be on Facebook, they might be on Snapchat, whatever it is. 52% of online adults now use two or more social media sites, and the average social media user maintains at least five accounts. So that means, you know, like on my phone, I have Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, Snapchat, and fill in the blank. I don't know what else I have on there, but here's the average minutes spent per day by platform. So the average American spends 40 minutes on Facebook, 34 minutes on Tumblr. Is anyone on Tumblr? That makes sense because that's more of a kind of a tweens platform. A lot of younger folks spend a lot of time looking at posts there, sharing posts. Then we have 21 minutes on Instagram, 21 on Pinterest, 17 on Twitter, 17 on Snapchat, and about 10 on LinkedIn. So just kind of putting things in perspective. But to Ryan's point earlier, we encourage you to be strategic about where you invest your time, energy, and money, especially if you're doing it yourself. You only have so much time, and it's easy to kind of get caught in the trap of trying to do everything. Just a quick example, Royal Hawaiian is the company Ryan worked for, is firm one in this example. So email marketing was important, Twitter worked, blogging worked, Instagram worked, Facebook and LinkedIn worked. For firm two, the loan agency I worked for, we did some videos because it was a good way, so YouTube, to communicate what the heck they were. Nobody ever heard of a CDC unless you were in the industry. So it was good to communicate to small businesses that this was available. Twitter was good. We just kind of put out quick updates, there was, you know, a lot of lone people that checked that. Google Plus was a more professional platform at the time, so we leveraged that, and we leveraged LinkedIn as well. So think about those 10 or so social media platforms that we showed earlier, and start to think about, okay, where do I want to spend my time? Where does my customer spend their time? Are they, you know, Facebook's kind of got everybody on there, but Facebook's really good about allowing you to target your advertising as well. So you can pick very specific groups you want to talk to. For Ryan and I's business, these are the three platforms that we focus on for our workshops and boot camps and speaking engagements. We like Instagram because it allows us to be visual. We like Facebook. There's a lot of interaction on there. And we use LinkedIn because we want to talk to business professionals.
So for anyone, is anyone running a business right now, or has anyone in their family or friends circle that is running a business? Yeah. Are they leveraging social today? No. Is that, and what's the business, just out of curiosity?
It's a business.
Oh, okay. So your business that you were talking about? No. Okay, gotcha. So it's interesting. A lot of folks, our dad has about 7 locations. They sell body jewelry in San Diego. My dad doesn't really understand social, and in sort of the back of his head, it's like, well, do I even need to be there? Like, do we need to? And some of the evidence that we showed you just now is that your customers are going to be spending time on these platforms. It's just about picking which platform is the right spot for you to spend your time. At the very least, let's say you don't have the bandwidth to post things on a really regular basis. It's important for you to at least start those profiles. A couple of reasons, and we can link it back to SEO. So not only does Google look at your local page or your website, they're also searching where else is your website linked online. And is it linked somewhere reputable? So on any social profile, you can actually link your website. Hey, what's my, you know, company website? You can put it there. And that's sending another signal to Google that, hey, you know what, this company is talked about in more than one place. Okay, so there's other sources. So at the very least, you want to go out there and start these profiles in the appropriate spots so that you get those links out there. Okay, you're getting signals pointing back to yourself. Now, on the converse of that, if you don't ever go post any content, that's going to look a little weird as well. So you want to find time to sort of crawl, walk, run. Make sure, from a crawling perspective, that you start those profiles. As you start to see engagement, maybe you start using a little bit more time, have one of your employees, if you have extra bandwidth that they may be able to leverage, find a family friend, hire an intern, right? They work for free, right? Not really, but. So I definitely say go with the crawl, walk, run. Start getting your feet in that pool, because you will start to see the engagement over time. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
One input that I would have is that in our marketing class, when we visit our clients, we'll see a branding error, which would be profiles not complete,
yep,
on the different sites, and then inconsistent profiles, which don't help the brand. And so a really high-impact practice is simply fill out the complete profile and do it in a consistent way across all your platforms.
That's a huge point. We'll talk about local marketing, which is something that we specialize with the big brands on. You'd be surprised, even for Walmart, across Google, Bing, Yelp, Facebook, Foursquare, for one location, without help, how inconsistent that can be, right? Even the phone number to a location or the address. Things that you would think in the back of your head are like a no-brainer. Of course these are going to be consistent across the board. Really get messy and clunky for a couple of reasons, which we'll touch on. Mm-hmm.
Here's some other fun facts that we like to talk about. People share 1.3 million pieces of content on Facebook every minute of every day. So back to the content piece that Ryan was talking about, make sure that that content you're putting out there has great context, and it will encourage people to actually interact with it. There's a lot of noise. 1.3 million posts. What are you going to do to be different, to be special, and to convey your value proposition to the customer? I made a joke earlier about checking your Facebook at a red light. 27% according to this recent survey, 27% of Facebook users admit to checking the mobile app while driving. That is a scary stat, very scary stat. There's nothing more important than making sure that you stay safe and you keep the people around you safe, but 27% of people have decided to not fulfill that promise that they made when they got their license. Okay, sorry, I'll get off my soapbox. Users consider pictures posted on Instagram to be 2.7% cooler than if that same picture was posted on another platform.
You know, I was at a conference and met a guy from Instagram who's doing a presentation, and they were saying that they ran a test. They took the same exact image, they posted it on Twitter, posted it on Instagram, Facebook, and Pinterest, and every study that came back, no matter what image they posted, it was the same exact one, everyone perceived it as just a little bit cooler, right? And that's what they call the Instagrammy effect, like, is a picture Instagrammy or not? And that's a coin that they termed. But I think that's pretty fascinating to think about. Instagram is one area that James and I have put a lot of focus on lately because it's seen tremendous growth amongst a lot of different demographics. And they're really building out quite a robust advertising platform that's actually right in line with Facebook. I don't know if you guys know, but Facebook bought Instagram a few years back. And so now when you run advertising on Instagram or Facebook, you can actually cross-promote on both platforms, and that's a fantastic one-two punch. So keep your eye out. If you're not on Instagram, I think that's a good spot to start experimenting. One of the good things about Instagram, it's sort of built into the nature of Instagram that not only are you connecting with people you know, but also because there's hashtags at play, you can also connect with folks that you don't know. So from a brand, you can get some really neat exposure even if they're not following you.
And then you always want to think about engagement. This is kind of the KPI, the key performance indicator for social. People will say, well, what's your engagement for a post? So we want to kind of help you define what that is. And so when you're thinking about making a post, ask yourself, does it answer yes to one of these questions? Did you grab attention? Did you deliver delight or happiness? Did you cause people to want to share it? Right? Was it shareable? Hey, I want to share this with my friends. Did you initiate a discussion? So was it something that provoked a user to leave a comment or ask a question or make a statement, right? That's engagement. Did you cause people to take an action? So for Ryan and I, we're trying to get folks to join us at our boot camp. So our posts are about, hey, sign up. That's the action that we want you to take. And the last one is, did you deliver some sort of economic value? So if your goal is to build brand awareness, then you're not necessarily concerned about the economic value, but if your goal is to sell a product, then you have to be able to say, okay, is this post going to increase sales? Is it going to increase the bottom line? And that's kind of our quick overview of social media. We'll go into email marketing, which is the next pillar of our digital marketing strategy.
How many, just on average, how many times a day do you guys go in and check email? Yeah. How early do you, like, from waking up, when do you first check email? Is it pretty right away?
4:30.
Yeah.
Wow. And so you say 20 times a day.
Yeah.
What is your average session time? Like, are you kind of going through emails at 30-minute blocks and times 20?
Yeah, I've got to check my email.
Yeah.
the phone, right, has a notification,
yeah.
So
right.
Usually if the headline looks like it's urgent, then I'll open it right away.
Right.
Otherwise, I leave it, so...
Gotcha.
Fun question. I try my best not to look at email until I get into the office. But how many of you sleep with your phone or a phone is pretty close by? A lot. The phone's pretty close by. So my alarm will go off sometimes before I even roll out of bed. I'm like, what do I got going in the inbox? Like, it's mind blowing. But I think just based off of the room survey here, it shows that email can be a really effective place to actually connect with customers because there is a frequency that we all participate in, right? Because there are important things going on in your email as well. So you're going to check for those things. How many of you sign up for newsletters or special offers or anything like that with the brands that you interact with? You do? I do. What's the best offer you guys have gotten recently? that encourage you to actually go make a purchase?
Well, like text messages for,
okay.
for coupons, basically, like a code,
cool.
a promo code.
Nice. So for us, we were in the market for some new suits, and we like Express. So they said for every, we got an email, we're on their newsletter thing, for every $100 you spend, we'll give you $40. So it was basically almost half off. It was 40% off. So
so we got in the car and
we went to Express because it expired that night. So we had to go. So that's like the perfect example of email marketing working well, right? Here's the definition real quick. Email marketing is directly sending a commercial message to someone, typically to a group or people using email. In its broadest sense, every email sent to a potential or current customer could be considered email marketing. It usually involves using email to send ads, request business, or solicit sales or donations, and is meant to build loyalty, trust, or brand awareness. Email marketing can be done to either sold lists or current customer databases. So I personally prefer to only receive email marketing from people that I opted into, but it is very true that companies will buy lists, right? And there's sometimes when you get an email from someone that it's clear they bought a list, you're automatically like, this is spam, I'm out, like, don't email me. So here's a fun tip. If you want to receive like a lot less spam, we buy a lot of domain names. It's an extra cost to make your information private. But I've noticed it's worth like the 10 extra bucks because when you sign up for a domain name, your information is out there. And I cannot tell you like how many people email us about, we'd like to optimize your website. And it's all like their emails are all spelled like that. The spelling is horrible. You can tell it's like offshored, but it's one of those things where, man, if you want to stay away from that, just pay the extra money, make your name private on those URLs. Some fast facts about email marketing that I find fascinating. And these facts are really one of the reasons why James and I made about a $500 investment this year to get on an email marketing platform. We were always very apprehensive about it, but we've started to see that there's some good results. So we've ended up the money, but or ponied up the money. But so this is according to some recent research by the Direct Marketing Association. So the ROI on an email is about 3,800%, according to that association that I just mentioned. 72% of people would rather receive promotional material via email than social media. And 38% of people say receiving special offers is the top reason they subscribe to email lists. Okay, so what does this mean? You've got a highly engaged group. Sometimes it looks like, you know, to the tune of 72%, the email marketing can be more effective than the social posts that you may put out there in terms of actual ROI growth, right? So it's hard sometimes to track the value of a like. But with email marketing, if you're putting out a specific promotion, there's tracking that you can work into it, code that will show who clicked, did they go to your website, and did they make a purchase, right? And then 38% of people say they'll normally opt into these sort of lists if they know they're gonna get special offers. So what does that mean? As a business owner, sometimes to get people to opt in, you'll say, hey, sign up for this list for special deals and promotions, or sign up for this list for 50% off your next purchase, right? That's how you can get people engaged. And a lot of people we consult with go, I don't want to give a percentage off for signing up for this list. What does this list mean? Well, the facts here are that this is a great group to communicate with and build loyalty for. So here's five more reasons that we think it's important to start thinking about email marketing, but also why you need to start building out a list for your email marketing. So email, like we were mentioning, outperforms Twitter and Facebook for selling online. People are more inclined to click on your offer and go, especially if that message is personalized in some sort of way. And the email tech is getting so sophisticated now where it can auto-generate your name, but it goes further than that. It can actually put together a customer profile to start serving up emails for your customers that are more relevant to them based off of their previous purchases or information that you've gathered about them. You can even automate things like, hey, we know this person's birthday. On this day, just go ahead and send them a happy birthday deal or message, right? So I don't know about you, but when I get that free drink from Starbucks for my birthday, I feel pretty cool about it, right? So the tech is in a place where you can set that up.
You get a free drink on your birthday too? yet. I thought they were only sending that to me. Gosh.
Nice.
I don't feel as special now.
That's pretty funny. That's the first time he's ever said that.
That's true.
Number two, it's getting more difficult to strategically climb Google's ranking algorithms. So organic is getting harder and harder. James shared techniques earlier about SEO and how to rank, but sometimes it does become difficult to always pop up number one for every keyword. This is why it's important to, if you have a previous customer or someone who's opted into the list, why not send your information to them first? Remind them that you're there. They're not always going to go, you know, research for you or go to their bookmarks and head back to your site. Email is content marketing's best friend. So a couple minutes ago, we talked about why it's important to create really great content. Well, it's easy for any business, but for us, we like doing this. We send out our monthly newsletter, and we'll include links to our top five blog posts that month, right? So it allows you to get your stuff out there in front of people just in case they didn't see it on one of the other channels that you're displaying that content. Email drives traffic and sales, which we talked about, especially when you look at something like, hey, come in for a free drink at Starbucks. It's very rare that I just get the free drink. I always get the banana or the croissant, right? So
you know what they say about the bananas at Starbucks?
No.
No, neither do I. I was hoping you could tell me. I'm sorry.
I think I always listen. Here's the thing. I'm very particular about my bananas. Bananas at Starbucks are always not ripe enough for me, and I don't know why I keep buying them. I think it's going to be different. They're never ripe. But anyways, five. Not that you needed to know that information about me. Five. Email allows you to build a relationship, like we've mentioned, and really build that trust between customers and potential future customers. So, important stuff. We've been seeing a lot of great engagement. There's different things that you want to keep in mind, though. So, there are anti-spam laws out there. So, it's important that you be ethical about who you're emailing, when you're emailing, and you give them the option to opt out. It's actually interesting, when you sign up for an email marketing platform, there's a new law out there, or at least I think there is, but this is what I've seen. You have to put your address in the system so that if a user wanted to know, okay, where is this email coming from, they can track it down. So if you don't see that, then you know that the person's probably sending it pretty unethically. They've just bought a list and they're sending it out there. Or maybe they've neglected to put it in there. But that was one thing that the platform we jumped on required us to do. And they said it was a law that you have to actually have a way to identify yourself. I just put our work address on there because I wasn't really willing to put my home address. So there's ways around having someone actually have your personal info. And you always want to make sure that you offer a way to opt out. I'm noticing that it's harder and harder to find the opt out button, and some people will add additional steps. Hey, are you sure you want to opt out? You know, can we give you other information that would be valuable? But you have to stay on level and give folks a way to jump out. Here's a quick list of different platforms that are out there. At Royal Hawaiian, we used to use MailChimp. It's great because there's a freemium model there. So you get X number of emails for free right off the bat. If you want to start experimenting with email marketing, I think MailChimp's a really great way to go. And it will integrate with a lot of the different website providers that are out there, whether it's Squarespace or Weebly or anyone that you're working with, for the most part, can plug in, which is cool. So as people are making purchases on your website, their information automatically will get included on your email list, which is great.
Cool. Let's talk about digital advertising. This is a... As we kind of progress through the seven principles, we're getting into some areas that become a little bit more like intermediate level, right? So you've built out your website and you have your SEO tightened up. Great. You've tightened up your social media. Now it's time to start maybe doing some digital advertising. You can advertise on social media platforms like Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever it is. One that we spend a lot of time advertising on is Google AdWords. And so I'd like to speak a little bit more about search engine marketing. So that's where we'll focus our conversation on digital advertising. But if you have any other questions about other platforms, please feel free to chime in. So here's the definition. Search engine marketing, or SEM, is a form of internet marketing that involves the promotion of websites by increasing their visibility in search engine results pages, or SERPs, primarily through paid advertising. SEM may incorporate search engine optimization, SEO, which adjusts or rewrites websites' content and site architecture to achieve a higher ranking in search engine result pages to enhance pay-per-click PPC listings. A lot of information there. But as you'll notice, that digital marketing is it's a very intricate web, right? Everything kind of ties back. So we talked about SEO, and that connects to search engine marketing because you want to make sure that that landing page that somebody clicks on when they do a Google search, they have those ads at the top. You want to make sure that when they click on that ad, they land on a landing page that's consistent with the ad. Because Google's doing the same kind of checks and balances to make sure, okay, does this ad's tagline match the title tag of the landing page, of the content on the landing page? So it all kind of integrates neatly together. Highly encourage you to make a Google AdWords account. It's free. Oftentimes, if you guys, you've probably participated in some of these projects at Cal State Fullerton, like Professor Atwong's class. I don't know if you've ever taken that digital marketing class, but Google actually does a project with CSUF where they'll give the class, you know, a pile of money basically. It's $250 per group to do some digital advertising. So if you have a class to pick up next semester, highly encourage that one. I encourage you to go on the Google AdWords, start an account, start kind of tinkering around. There's a lot of great videos and material to show you how to start your campaign. We'll kind of explain how to set things up. And then what I want to point out here is there's simple ads like the one you see for Cal Atlantic Homes, and then there's more kind of expert ads that use these ad extensions that incorporate different star ratings, location information, phone numbers. And so my challenge to you, again, go one inch higher. Start by doing some of these simple ads and work your way to some more of the intricate ads as you work through Google's kind of learning center and figure out different pieces that you can incorporate. Here's an example of some advertisements. So these are the search ads over here to the left and to the bottom right. The bottom right ads have actually been taken away for now, but just want to kind of build that out for you. And then on the right hand side, you can see what are called display ads. So display ads are a little bit different, but it's actually like serving up an image. So how many of you have gone to a website like Disneyland.com? You're saying, oh, when's the park open today? And then you go on CNN, and there's a Disneyland advertisement on CNN.
Is that it seems ever? To just follow you.
It just right? seems to follow you, right? It's magic, right? Pardon the pun. It's magic, Disneyland.
There you go.
Thank you.
Pity laugh.
Okay.
You know, if you got to explain the joke.
The joke, it's not as good.
I don't know.
But the moral of that story is that that's called remarketing or retargeting. So when you land on Disneyland's website, it's able to grab your IP address and drop what's called like a cookie, which I've always thought is kind of a funny name, or a pixel. And that will follow you along as you go on the internet. So when you go to CNN, they have Google display ads on there, and it says, oh, okay, this person was just on Disney.com. So I'm going to serve them up that ad. And when they go to their next website, NFL.com, I'm going to serve them up that ad. And they go to whatever, you know, blog that they like to go to, I'm going to serve them up that ad. Because there's a higher chance that you're going to be reminded, hey, I wanted to get those tickets at Disneyland, so let me click on the ad and take me over there. One of the classic rules, and you probably know it better than I do, but it used to be like you had to see an advertisement in a newspaper or TV 7 times before you took an action. Well, it's kind of the same idea here, but now the ad's following you around. So again, my challenge to you guys is think about how you can leverage Google AdWords to promote your business. And the nice thing is that, let me tell you a little bit more about the two platforms. You have the search network and the display network. The search network is targeting people that are looking for your types of products because you're bidding on keywords. So again, coming back to my shoe example, if somebody's looking for shoes, I can say I'm willing to pay $5 to show my ad the next time somebody searches shoes. It gets kind of complicated. It goes into this like real-time bidding thing because there's maybe 1,000 people that are all bidding for that keyword. So it takes into account your quality score. It looks at the landing page, the way your ad is written, and the click-through rate, like how often people actually interact with that ad. It gives you a score, and it adjusts the bidding. Think about it this way, though. Imagine 1,000 businesses are sitting in a room, and they're all saying, I want to buy the shoes ad. Someone types in shoes into Google, and within seconds, those three ads are displayed. Only 3 of those 1,000 people are going to get displayed on there. They won the bid, right? And that's just happening in real time, 24/7. So it's kind of interesting stuff. Display is a little bit different. People aren't necessarily looking for your product. Maybe they've engaged with your product, or maybe they've never heard of your product. Display is a good way to build brand awareness. So search engine marketing, good way to convert sales. People already know your product. Display advertising is a good way to inform people about your product, build brand awareness, and then hopefully that channels back to, oh, I'm curious about that advertisement I saw. Let me go search and click on your ads from there.
To survey the room, who clicks on ads? Anyone ever click on these ads? Isn't that mind-blowing?
Yeah.
This is Google's main source of income. And I can't find someone who admits to clicking on these things.
I think we do occasionally,
right.
But the stat that I quote in the class is about, you know, 86% prefer organic search results.
Absolutely.
About 14% will prefer or choose to click on the creatives, the ads, and yet it creates tens of billions of dollars of revenue for the industry. Amazing.
It's mind-blowing. Yeah. I click on ads when I'm searching a competitor. I'm going to cost them
you
money.
Right.
And then if I see one of our clients, I'll purposely not click on their ads because I want, you know. No, I'm just kidding. What do? I don't click. I do click because I want the money. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just joking.
They work, and they're instantaneous. That's, to me, that's the value proposition of AdWords, is that it can take weeks, months, years, for some cases, to get good organic results.
Yeah.
You can get same day, same hour results with AdWords. Very, very powerful. Rather expensive.
It's a sort of a running joke, but it's true in the digital marketing world. Like, you know, if someone comes up to me and says, Ryan, how do I get to page one? Pay for it. I mean, you'll get, you know, at the top of page one every time if you've got the right strategy in place. And there's different keywords that are worth different amounts of money. Some people will advise you go with the long tail approach where you're like, well, I'm going to do these really long keywords versus something specific, because shoes is highly competitive and you better bet that Nike is willing to pay more for that general keyword than you are, right? So you've got to base your
shot. And think about it this way too. So if you're selling a new house, your cost per click or that keyword might be $50 to $100, right? Because the return on investment is hundreds of thousands of dollars. If you're selling shoes or a pizza or whatever, okay, it's a $14 pizza, it's gonna be a 50 cent click or a dollar click or something like that. And sometimes we get caught up in like, okay, well, I have to spend $500 on these advertisements, but what if you, those $500 that you spent drove $600 in sales? You're up $100, or drives $1,000. Now you're up $500. So it's kind of that pay to play model, to your point, but you can get pretty quick results. So definitely encourage you to take time. We'll blow this out a lot during our boot camp and get into some more details. But now we'll go to online reviews.
This is one of the most exciting things that's going on right now in the digital space. There's this slide that we'll show during the boot camp, and anyone can Google it, but go look at the number of digital marketing companies that are out there today that offer different platforms, similar to Brandify, that we've been around for 19 years, but 5 years ago, there was like 150 different people offering digital marketing solutions. Now there's about 3,500 companies that have a platform or a dashboard that you can go on. And one of the areas that we're all moving towards right now is, how do we help our customers get more reviews on platforms like Yelp or Google? But then how do we also encourage people to leave reviews on platforms that they own, like the brand website and things like that? And the reason why we're so excited about it is because Google and Bing and all the search engines are showing that they're actually building the opinions of people who are leaving reviews into the search result algorithms, okay? So what do I mean by that? We see examples where a small mom and pop shop might outrank a Walmart in local search because they have more reviews online left by more people that are positive reviews, right? So if a Walmart has, let's say, just hypothetically, a 5-star review, but only one reviewer, and the mom and pop's got a 4-star rating, but they've got 14 reviewers, we've seen instances where that mom and pop gets served up higher because there's more people leaving a positive opinion. So how do you influence that at a business level? You ask your customers who have had good experiences to go out there and leave reviews for you on these different spots. Google's looking at the reviews and pushing up pages based off of the positive feedback that's happening out in the world. So 7 in 10 Americans seek out opinions before making purchases, and we're actually starting to see a lot of data that people trust the opinions they read online rather than if they got that same opinion from their own friend. Because it's a little bit more of, it's crowdsourced, more opinions are coming in, and you can see trend lines, right? So you can see, oh, they get a lot of 5-star reviews, and so that opinion actually holds more weight than a friend who says, no, that place is great, you should go. We're seeing in search ranking signals that Google, like I was mentioning, is starting to look at the velocity, so how often do reviews come in, the quantity, how many reviews do you have, and then the diversity. So how many different people is it coming from and what sort of social authority do they have? And so you're seeing it's growing more and more, the sort of chunk of the search result that is influenced by how good a review is. So if you're wondering, where do these reviews, where do they populate? Where are you seeing them? Where can people leave them? Well, you've probably seen it on your phone if you've got iPhone or if you've ever done a Google Maps search. All of these platforms now are building in places for folks to actually go ahead and leave a review and leave a star rating. And like I mentioned, this is influencing a lot of what you see in the search results. This is kind of crazy, but this is the review ecosystem. So all of these platforms today that you're seeing, whether it's TripAdvisor, Bing, Google, YP, Yahoo, they all offer the ability for folks to leave reviews for businesses. And Google is actually looking at all of these different places to see how well spoken about your business is. And so they're factoring that into the SEO, the strength of your website and to your local listings. So we don't have to dive too far into this, but if you are running a business today and you're getting reviews, in the past, the old school of thought was, well, I don't necessarily care what people are saying online. Here's the reality, and we share this with a lot of our clients. The buying power today is going more and more towards millennials. And the studies show that millennials are less likely to actually go up and complain to a person. They're more likely to go online and leave that review in places like Facebook, Yelp,
passive aggressive, actually, but yes. So yeah. They have a hard time doing it in person.
Right, yeah, absolutely. So
what are you saying about millennials? There's a few of us in this room right now, and you know we won't take that.
But so they have
that's aggressive.
That is, yeah, that's less passive, less passive, more aggressive.
So they have the buying power, but they're less likely to go take that complaint offline. And when someone complains offline, typically that's the fastest path to getting the outcome that you want, right? But that online complaint, in the past, people weren't responding to it. Companies weren't responding. And they weren't realizing how it's hurting their search results, right? So now what we're advising is you have to go ahead and respond to these reviews. And each platform will let the company do so. And you look as you were that location, and you can respond. When you leave, when you respond to a negative review, what ends up happening is a lot of times we see the person who left that negative review will edit their rating. They'll go back, and then a lot of these platforms will let you adjust it, and they'll have a little, you know, edited on note. And the person, we see a lot of folks going, hey, you know what, I had this bad experience, but I'm really impressed at how they took care of it.
So sometimes the negative review is a request for information.
Oh, yeah.
And the site owner can go back and explain it, and take action. So if the the negative review is correct, we'll thank them for it, take corrective action, and then celebrate it.
Right.
And here's another example. There was a small store in my neighborhood that didn't have a website, and you know what the number one search result was? A negative review.
Right.
Wow. And I went into the guy and I said, oh my God, you got to respond to it. By the way, build a website, because when people searched for that store, they found this place sucks.
Yeah. And that's such a critical point, and large brands are challenged with that as well, you know. So we advise that folks go on there and will respond to that. And believe it or not, it's kind of a PR play. You're making right. And folks are impressed by that, and then the customer is more than likely going to go back and edit their response or take it down altogether. And how does that help you from a digital perspective? We already know that the algorithms are looking at it, right? So if someone adjusts their review, your average score just went up for the review ratings. Or if they take it down, again, your score is going to go up. So it's important to engage.
One point I want to make before we move on, and it's we have about 20 minutes left. I hope you guys are finding value in all this.
Mm-hmm.
So good, I saw nods. Okay. Is that you want to respond to positive reviews as well, because that helps build loyalty, right? So it's not just like the, you always joke, you know, the squeaky, was it squeaky wheel?
Gets
the
squeaky wheel.
Yeah, it gets the grease.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. I want to make sure I'm saying that right. So that's a lot of times often in reviews too, where people look, okay, we got to talk to the negative people, but you also want to encourage the positive people that are saying nice things, that are leaving the 5-star reviews, because then they can become a brand advocate. They're going to be more likely to come back and feel like they have a personal connection and a personal relationship with the brand. So we encourage people to spend 70% of their time responding to negative reviews, but also to take 30% of their time to make sure that they're sharing some positive messages as well. And I loved what you said. I took a note of it. Celebrate, right? So if it's a negative experience, how did we make it better and celebrate that? But also a positive experience, how can we celebrate that and socialize it with people as well? One thing that I saw that I really loved, again, with your businesses, highly encourage this, Slater's 50-50. I don't know if you guys have had a burger there before. They have a little card that the server brings out every time that says, hey, we love Yelp reviews. But if you have a problem, talk to the manager first. So that's a great idea, because you're saying, hey, we want you to leave that positive review, but if you had a negative experience, just talk to us. We'll make it better. And we're seeing a lot of our clients start to do things like that because they understand how powerful that review is. It goes on there, it stays on there forever, and it impacts where your listing shows up compared to another. Which brings us to our next point. So, any questions about reviews before we go on to the last principle, listings management? All right, so JJ brought up a great point earlier about these different platforms and making sure your profile's filled out all the way, making sure that the information's consistent. For that karate dojo that I consulted for, on Google, their name was spelled one way. On Facebook, their name was spelled differently. On Foursquare, it had capitals in the wrong places. On LinkedIn, it was all capitalized, right? So you want to make sure that it's consistent across all platforms. But let's kind of start at the top and work our way down. So near me searches, people that are saying pizza near me, shoes near me, whatever it is, has increased 34 times. The volume of those searches has increased 34 times since 2011, according to Google. So that means people are looking for things in their local, in their hometown, right? Like, I need to find this item now. And so what that looks at is a lot of the kind of old school digital marketing is focusing on that main keyword, pizza or takeout or delivery. With this new school approach is the long tail. I need to rank for pizza in Fullerton, takeout in a certain postal code. Sometimes I'll type in a zip code, pizza 92563, right? Or, this is a horrible example, but delivery in a given state. It's a little broad.
Yeah, it's a little broad.
It's a little broad, but that works.
Maybe Rhode Island.
Yeah, yeah, it's a small state. I drove all the way through Delaware one time, and that was kind of a small state, and there wasn't a lot going on. So maybe that's a good example there, too. Yeah. That's exactly what I did. But the idea there is that you want to capitalize on those local searches. And so the platforms that you kind of see below, all of these offer this kind of Yellow Page-esque experience, but in digital. So Bing, Foursquare, Google, Yelp, Facebook, and then the last four, Neustar, Factual, Axiom, and Infogroup, all, you know, eight of these focus on how do I take your business's information and make sure that's consistent and accurate across multiple platforms. That's what we do at Brandify, though, because when you have one store, it's easy to, well, it's not easy, it's time-consuming, but if you take the time and sit down, you can go out and claim and make sure that you're consistent on Bing, that you're consistent on Foursquare. Start getting to 2, 3, 4, 5 stores, it gets a little tougher. So the last four will help you kind of push that consistent information. The first five, you need to go in and actually take control and edit the listing, edit the hours, edit the phone number. So highly encourage you to take the time to make the accounts on these, just if nothing else, if you're not gonna engage and post on them, to make sure that it's got the right name, the right address, the right phone number, the right store hours. Because there's nothing more frustrating than showing up to a bar that on their social media says it's, you know, there's karaoke that night, and then you try to call them on Google and the phone number is wrong, and then you try to look for the phone number on Bing and it's wrong, and Yelp it's wrong, so you show up anyways, and they don't have karaoke that night. There's nothing more frustrating than that.
James is big on karaoke. One thing that's fascinating to think about, so you might be saying, like, well, the information's wrong across these profiles. Like, why would the business owner go in there and do that? It's sometimes not the business owner. All right? Google is creating listings for every business out there based off of its crawling. So it might see some information on the local Chamber of Commerce website and create a listing for that based off of name, address, phone number information. It's creating them no matter what, because it's creating a Yellow Page-like experience, and they want to have as much information as possible. That's why they give you the ability to go claim that listing. So you can say, oh, I'm actually the owner of this. You prove it, and then you take over ownership. That's how you can make that information consistent across the web. So important to think about. In fact, when Google launched these listings, this program years ago, they went and had people go out and collect Yellow Pages. And they ripped out the pages and scanned them and had tech that would read the listing and automatically create it from a digital perspective, which is mind-blowing to think about, that that's how they would go about doing that. But they needed to start sourcing the information from somewhere. So moral story is here, especially if you have a local business where a beauty college, where you're trying to drive traffic. I know from personal experience, one of my roommates is a cosmetologist. She went to a beauty college. There's a lot of competition here in Orange County. So how can you make sure that you stand out, you have a strong website, you make sure that your listing is claimed, you make sure that you're encouraging your customers to leave reviews on these listings, you make sure that your listings are claimed across all the platforms and that all the information is consistent, and all of a sudden, if your competitors aren't doing that, you start to move up, move up, move up. And you could be the newest beauty college to hit the scene here in Orange County, but if you have all these little pieces moving in the background and digital, you can rank above people that have been around forever that don't think digital is important. Well, when, you know, at some ridiculous number, 80% of people consult their smartphone first, do a Google search before making a purchasing decision. And if you show up, then that's potentially business that you're taking away from your competitors. The other piece that I wanted to note was those kind of four that I shared earlier, Axiom, Local Leads, Factual. This is a service that you can buy into, and they're what we call syndicators. So they take your location data and they push it out to different GPS systems like TomTom and Neustar and OnStar and all those systems that might be in your car. So think about potentially investing in that as well to make sure that your location information is as consistent and accurate across as many platforms as possible. And the point I wanted to make was, for our dad, it's the challenge. He's got 7 locations. We do that for him. Imagine if you're like Walmart and you have 6,000 locations. It gets a little bit more difficult. So just to tell you a little bit more about what we do at Brandify, we'll do
that kind of hands-on, making sure that the phone numbers and hours are all accurate and consistent for our companies. Okay, so to recap, we talked about website and SEO, content, social media, email marketing, digital advertising, online reviews, and we finished with listing management. It was when Travis and JJ invited us here to spend some time with you guys tonight. It was a little bit of a challenge to try and distill our 6-hour course into an hour and 45 minutes or so. But hopefully it wasn't too overwhelming and you guys felt like you got some things out of it.